All right, I guess we'll start by doing a pledge into allegiance. Chris Oli.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, meeting comes to order at 5:30, 10:30, 24.
Mr. Chair. Before we start, can I just say something?
Go ahead.
This is our first meeting since the passing of John Borden. I'd like to ask the committee if we would take a moment of silence in honor of John's name, who did so much for not only the town, the river, but for this group.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, first thing on the agenda is to motion to approve the minutes from the last meeting. Everybody have a chance to read those? All in favor?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes from last.
Second.
I'll second.
Approved. Okay, having an update from Chris.
Sure. All right, good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming here. My name is Christopher Leonard, Director of Marine Services. We can start out with the relay and what we're doing right now. To date, we have 3,564 and a half bushels planted into the Westport River. Hopefully, we're going to make it to 5,000. I know the boat didn't go out today, and hopefully we'll be able to get that. We have our contract for that relay till December 31st, or when the water reaches 45 degrees, because there's no relay activity after the water hits that 45 degree threshold. So we have those relay quahogs in two areas right now. I think we've talked about this year planting within Half Moon Flat Relay. I think we have somewhere around 2,000 in there-ish. Might be a little shy of that. The rest, we're planting Ram Island. And then we can leave it open for discussion. We could plant it all in Ram Island, or we could plant the last 500 in the Shiprock to Sunk Rock area. Do we have any thoughts on that?
What do you typically put in Ram Island?
Around 2,000. I feel like Ram Island could hold a substantial amount, but the Shiprock to Sunk Rock area has come in key specifically this year, as it is in an unconditional area. So, I mean, I would like to see it planted in there. I've talked to the state. We are ready to do that for the last 500. It is nice, too, when we get to the last 500, to be able to have a quick trip and put it to bed. I don't know if there's any comments or concerns about that. As we plant Ram Island, though, and talking with people like Jay White, there are areas within Ram Island that is, you know, really hard bottom. So we try to not plant around the edges of the relay if we have to. I know sometimes we've had some really low tides at Ram Island and we can't really get too far into Ram Island. So if there's any thoughts about the planting there, it would be open for discussion for this advisory committee.
Chris, just a thought and talking with other people. The value of, and I know it's in an unconditional area, but the value of Shiprock, Sunk Rock, where very few people fish that. It's kind of a go-to place when you get jammed up, when there's, rain issues or whatever.
Sure.
Versus, I mean, we know who goes out there. We know who. There's a few people that fish it every day. And the flip side being that Ram Island, it's such a big area.
Yeah.
And 2,000 bushels equaling to 2,000 or 2,500, whatever it is, over Half Moon. I mean, we could probably put 5,000 in Ram Island. It's so big, acreage-wise. But there are issues there with water, getting in there, low water. kind of open a discussion on what the committee thinks of the value of Shiprock, Sunk Rock versus putting more into Ram Island because of the vast acreage over there.
Well, I think that the value that I see is that it's unconditional.
Right.
So when you can't fish the other areas,
you can go over there.
You can go there. So it's whether or not they'll be disciplined enough to leave that for, you know, a rainy day or not, I don't know. But it seems to make sense.
Yeah, it's a hot area to fish. You got to deal with the current. Like, you put your brake down.
Oh, it is. And it's all hard bottom, too.
It's wicked hard bottom.
Yeah.
But 500 bushels isn't that much. Just
it's something. I mean, in history's past, it's nice to plant more than two areas. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'd like to make that point.
I think that's
because we can look right now just like what's on the table for us. We can start in the West Branch. Judy's Island and the 294 River Road Relay areas are two separate areas. That was all considered one area up until I think about last year. So we have two areas in the West Branch. Then we have the Shiprock to Sunk Rock area. We have Half Moon Flat. And then we have David Road. And then we have Great Island to Upper Spectacle Island with the two. So that would give us six total relay areas, correct? I think if we have six areas, we should plant them.
Yeah.
That's just my off-the-cut feeling about that whole thing. Chris,
is there another place aside from Shiprock that we could establish? And what does it take? If there is, what would it take to establish that?
We would have to go through, I believe, to prove that it's an unproductive bottom. We would have to go and have a lot of surveys done through the state if we wanted to start a new area. I know that David Road might be pretty dug out, but for us to start planting 500 bushels up there and then have the season end and then have it close for a long point, it just seems like it's kind of a big area to only put 500 into.
Yeah.
Just because that would be, in just looking at everything, that would be our only other option, unless we wanted to start planting somewhere up in the West Branch, but I feel the Judy's Island Relay, the 294 River Road Relay, were open for a little bit, but they haven't been hit as hard as, say, David Road.
294 River Road is another tough spot to get into.
Oh, yeah.
Either side, I mean, you've got to hit it, much like Shiprock, you've got to hit it either side of the high tide, you know, within an hour or so, get in and get out, otherwise you're there for the night.
Yeah.
That's a tough spot to
get into. That is a very tough
That's
spot.
That's probably the toughest spot in the whole river to get into, or get out of, more importantly.
I'd say, yeah.
So it's got to be determined to be unproductive bottom.
I think there's a couple of other things. I can talk to Terry from the Division of Marine Fisheries, who's our point person to do the water testing, to do all of that kind of stuff. If we have talked about other areas. One of them, it's just, we don't want the area to come out of water at low tide either for a freezing factor. It's something that we've dealt with before. And then I think the other areas that we talked about, it was probably like north of Shiprock on the western shore. There's like a little piece, but it's just a little piece. And it was something that we kind of said, it's kind of behind the rocks that are behind that rock pile northwest of Shiprock.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of room up there. We also talked about the flat that is, if you're at the boat ramp looking at the point to the right, that's too close for people to be just...
It'll be in the way of launching and...
It would be in the... And it's just, we don't... When we plant a relay area, we don't want to make it easy for people to hop out of their car, go run around, do whatever, and then, you know, the types of areas that we have are pretty high visibility areas. The 294 River Road, we have somebody living in that house. A lot of the relay areas, David Road, Great Island to Upper Spectacle Island, we have all those houses. We have a lot of help from people that are in the houses that have my phone number, that if somebody's in there at a time when it's closed or contaminated, that they'll call me and say, hey, what's going on? We see a green skiff here doing some stuff. Is that open? So it's nice to have like the high visibility areas. I would say Ram Island is and Half Moon Flat are probably two of there aren't too many people. I mean, it's not like a house, because I know that we've had noise complaints too before, when we had, we would plant Gunning Island to Upper Spectacle Island, and we had some problems with people being rather loud early in the morning in front of people's homes, which is something that I don't really want to do either, so.
There was an area, to keep going past Ram Island, going east, and then it headed north along the marsh. Gary had an area there. He did it 1 year.
Oh, that's another tough.
So that must be.
That was another. Done.
Up by Speaking Rock?
Up
not
by
that far. You're not just halfway far. There, and yeah. It was like a strip of marsh.
Okay.
There was a strip of marsh. I do remember planting there, and that was kind of difficult to get in there at low tide, yeah, also. Yeah. I don't know if that's
that
still.
Is an,
I don't know if that's still on the books with the state.
I was just going to say, is that one still available?
I think that was given back to just become the Westport River and not a relay site.
There was a lot of scallops there that year. Well, there were a lot of scallops everywhere, but there was right along that marsh.
Yeah.
All right. I would suggest we go with the 500 at Ship Rock.
Yeah, I mean,
it's not going to take away from.
Seeing we have six relay sites, I mean, it's nice to plant three of them, and it's just, it's money in the bank, and we can keep it closed until we...
Keep it active. Yeah.
Until we decide otherwise.
Keep what if you just active. Use Ship Rock as, you know, if you have a really low tide?
That's also another thing, because we deal with the low tides. We deal with breakdowns. I mean, we had to put some into Half Moon Flat because we had a fuel pump that died in the 24-foot Carolina skiff, so we had to push it up there with the 17-foot skiff with a 50 horse. So now when you have 80 bushels, a 24-foot Carolina skiff, four people in the skiff, the dead outboard and everything else, that poor little 50 horse does not want to have to go on a three-hour tour. You know what I mean? So it is nice to have a quick dump zone, especially when we have things like that, just to keep us running.
How much notice do you need to close that? Can you just do it?
If I were to call the state, they could have it. Let's just say I called the state today. They could close it at sunrise for tomorrow morning if there wasn't any hiccups. But usually I like to give anybody just a heads up and some time. I just, like anything, as municipal gears turn, they seem slow. You know, it's slow to turn. So.
So having said all this, when do you think that might close? When would be an opportune time to close Ship Rock?
When we have 500 to go.
500, when we have the last 500.
Yeah. So at, you know, so we have another 500 to go into Ram Island, and that would probably give us a window of at least 6 days.
How many bushel in one trailer load when you do one load?
One load, it's anywhere from, let's just say, 60 some to, I think our biggest load this year was 92 or 3.
One load a day.
And one load a day, yep.
So 500 bushels would be
5 days plus.
At least, yes, so it would be 6 days. Yeah.
6 to 7 days.
At a minimum, and that's without breakdowns, without.
Yeah, that's nose. Everything going smooth.
There's so many moving parts that could, as we can see, we didn't go today. There's so many things, any variables that could.
And we never know, even if they are dredging, we never know what we're going to get till we get there.
So, but I think regarding
the other part of it,
regarding the low tide, you probably should try to get that closed soon, then, because if next week's going to be low tide, so you might have to dump some over there.
Yeah,
not
next week.
A little bit.
Yeah, that's a possibility. And if anybody has any objections to closing it that early, I know that still some people do utilize that as an unconditional area. We did have a really good stretch without rain, so there were other places to go, but.
It was closed last year at this time,
I know.
Mm-hmm.
To get it to finish the relay.
To get it to finish, yeah.
Yeah, so it's nothing different.
Yeah, I mean, it seems that it's a good. Not that anybody's opposed to going for a three-hour tour up the West Branch with a half tide falling, but that Ship Rock to Sunk Rock area is great to just be able to sprint to the finish.
Get in quick.
Yeah, because this is every year, 5,000 bushels, it's a bear. It's a bear. I mean, Gary Sherman had the highway department helping out for a while. Then they said, this is, you know, we need to go on our own.
You got grass to cut.
Yeah, luckily we have, a really good volunteer crew. But at the same point in time, we are ready to do it with a very shortened crew list. I mean, I have a come-along, I have a hand truck, I have ramps. If we have to move the stacks of six boxes into the skiff with a hand truck and ramps, I mean, that could be done with one person. And then you go out to the site, you throw the boat in just a controlled spin, and then you just start dumping. I mean, it's nothing new for us because, I mean, I feel like I've been unloading fishing boats for years and thousands of pounds of, whether it's monkfish skate wings, whatever. To do it for the full 5,000 bushels, yeah, no thank you. But when you get caught a day, people have doctor's appointments, they need to get their passports renewed. X, Y, and Z happens, and sometimes not everybody can make it, but I can definitely applaud the volunteers that have helped continually to make this a really smooth transition, because it's gone from the days of unloading like a 10-wheel dump truck, or maybe not, I don't think it was a 10-wheel, but
it used to be the town truck.
The town dump truck. When you have onion bags with the town dump truck, and everything's got to go over your head and under your head. I think right now, where we're on the ramp,
you used your own boat back then too.
You use your own boat, yeah, and that came with its own issues, because then you say, hey, where's Ronnie and Skip? they're off in space on their own thing. Oh, sorry, we broke down. Well, what happened to everything? Because I know in the past that rubbed some people the wrong way. I think right now with that 24-foot Carolina skiff, it's a heck of a boat that can move a lot of people and a lot of things for short money, too. I mean, in the boating world, I think that boat motor and trailer costs somewhere around $24,000. And what are you going to get for that in today's world? I mean,
hang on to it.
No, it's a workhorse.
Oh, yeah. No, it's great.
Finally, to Ron's point, though, if you wait till the end for the 500, you're going to take away the opportunity or the ability to avoid a really low tide at Ram Island.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Because we've been caught in that little cut going in there, and then that's where the buck stops. I mean, I believe that there is a 50-foot barrier. I'll have to double check. It's about a 50-foot that you need to stay away from a relay area, 50 feet. You can't be right on the buoy saying, oh, it's wrong, I'm across the line. No, there's definitely a no-go zone of about 50 feet. So if we had to plant the front apron and maybe move the balls out a little bit further into that channel in front, that's a possibility. We haven't had to do that yet, but yeah, we can look in, and I'll call the state and make that. If it's going to be really bad tide next week, then, you know, we'll be able to simultaneously plant Shiprock to Sunkrock, and then once the tide gets better, you know, we can finish it up. But I think 500 bushels in that area to plant three areas for the season would be a good idea. So that's my two cents.
Okay.
Sounds good.
Thank you, Chris.
All right. Oh, so we're still going with the update. All right, yes. Here we go. So with the relay done, I did have the opportunity from Rod Taylor, who has been a grower for us under the umbrella of Muscungus Bay. And he called and he said, hey, I have some overage. Sometimes towns have trouble committing for the full amount or just procuring any sort of money for relay, for seed growing. And seed is difficult. I mean, we've used ARC on the Cape before, and sometimes with not so great results. Nothing against them, but there's the factors where the pumps don't work. Things don't grow, things die, things whatever. I mean, we are dealing with Mother Nature here. Long story short, Rod called me and he said, hey, I have 150,000 10 to 14 millimeter quahog seed. I said, that's great. I said, what are we looking at? It was about $6,680. I said, wonderful, let's get those. So we did secure that and we did plant those near the rock. Richie Earle used to call it Red Rocks. It's the rock that, again, is northwest of Shiprock. There's an area that's like 500 feet north of Maskasatch Lane that they're kind of flat there. And then we planted the rest on the north of that rock where the rock buoy is. That's another kind of area. I've never planted that area before. And so we were able to plant.
What's the bottom like in there? A little bony in there?
It's muddy. It's bony if you head a little bit further north. I believe that it's the Chardon property. it can get kind of bony. There's like a bony edge over there.
What are you talking about?
Over on the Massey's Hatch side, right?
Heading north.
On the Massey's Hatch rock side?
Yeah, but north of that.
Yeah, north of that, where the buoys say that those sunken rocks.
Yeah, yeah. It's muddy in there, but if you keep on going beyond that, towards the shore in the west, it does get a little bit of rock.
That's deep too, doesn't it?
A little bit, but we just kind of planted them up on the flat. We would just try to broadcast them in previous days, and there was a thing to be said about if you're broadcasting them and they catch a little air bubble inside of them, it's not really a great thing. So we're playing around with techniques for that, and yet again, we put the boat in a controlled spin, and then off the stern, it creates kind of like a wave cycle that if you can put it into that wave cycle, it spins. There's like a cutting edge, the cutting edge when you're turning, and then just like the flowing edge. And it creates almost like a wave. And when the shellfish get into that, they kind of like spin around.
Tumble a little bit.
They tumble and then it goes out, which is really nice because a lot of the times when we go, we just dump a little bit. So it's just like a line, you know, like if you put a hole in a can of paint, and you're, you know, here's our little stream, and you follow the stream. So we were working with that technique to plant those, and it seemed to work really good. I don't know, we'll see, to just be able to tumble them and then, like, whoosh, it would spread them out, so.
How much was that cost?
$150,000.
No, how?
When?
Dollar value.
Oh, $6,680. I can give you my notes, too, if you want to just double-check that at the end.
I just want to fill the notes.
What was the size again?
10 to 14 millimeter, and I believe that's the field plantable size. We have planted in the past, or I have with Gary Sherman, much smaller stuff. Yet again, going with Mother Nature, and this is where I love the relay. It's a wild-caught thing, and the survival rate is wonderful. I would really only buy field plantable stuff unless it's going to go in our downwell or at the point or something like that that would be able to grow to that size. But it is such a small window that I don't want to plant anything smaller than that.
What's 10 to 14 millimeter, like a dime?
I don't know, thumbnail.
Nickel?
Pinky nail.
It's 25 and an inch, I believe, right? 25 millimeters.
Quarter inch.
And an inch.
Yeah, I got a ruler, yeah.
Oh, you got a ruler.
10 millimeters, 10 to 14 millimeters must be small.
It's somewhere like, thumbnail to pointer fingernail.
I don't know if it's a millimeter, though.
But, something like this. Really fast.
Chris, when did you broadcast those?
It was a couple of weeks ago because Gary was on vacation, and Rod said, I have them, and let's go.
Okay.
So I said, okay, here
if
we go.
If you wait till it's too cold, something might not dig in.
Yeah, we want to make sure that they're in a spot. Also, with that location, we don't want to plant them up in space where there isn't good tidal flow. We want to at least know that they have a good bottom, plenty of oxygen. I mean, predation for anything is always going to be an issue, but that's just, how
it's always it nice clean water there.
Yeah, yeah.
Where'd you put them again? You said north of the rock.
North of the Maskasatch Rock.
Yeah, somewhere like 500 feet north of Maskasatch Lane proper. Okay. There's a sign there, so it's at the end boundary of like the 1-inch closure area, more or less in the 1-inch closure area.
Buoy's the one on the west side, not on the right side. On the west side, not on the east side.
Correct.
Yeah, as you go further up, there's another rock buoy up there.
Yes. Yeah. Not. No, I didn't go over. I didn't cross the channel.
The rocks on the shore, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
So that was done. The next thing that we have is 100,000 bay scallops from Carrion. Carrion has been growing bay scallops. He has yearly bay scallops. We've yet to receive those and plant those. Similar to what we did last year. That we did plant 100,000 last year. And this is coming from, because we've planted bay scallops before that were very crazy kind of technicolor type of things. And these are coming from like a brood stock of a natural bay scallop. So it's not some sort of, let's just say, hybrid test tube.
It's not a genetic
lab mixture, which I'm all for. I'm not a huge fan of planting these kind of genetic things with as... We've talked about before, a thinner shell, it's not as hardy as an animal, and then the dealers end up with them, and then they end up dying on the dealer sometimes if they aren't moved along quickly. And so, as far as I'm concerned, I would want to plant more wild if we could. Sometimes we can't, but if we have that choice, we want to make that choice.
Rod doesn't do that anymore?
No. No.
So they don't, they haven't arrived yet, and we haven't paid for them yet, correct?
That's right.
Where are we going to put them?
Well, we went out and we surveyed a lot of the bottom, and this was back with Gary Sherman. Clyde McKenzie is a person that has worked with the Division of Marine Fisheries, very smart guy. And we did, I think it was 50 bottom samples with kind of a small clamshell, sort of dredge, not dredge, but a little clamshell. You'd throw it over, it would scoop up the dirt, scoop up the bottom sediment, and then you would say, is this noxic mud? Like, what's coming up? Because we don't want, with all this work, we don't want to put them in a place that they're going to get choked out, whether it's in eelgrass that then has all the brown slime and all the kind of dendritic slime that's there. We want to be able to put them in good moving water and allow them to move to the locations that they want to move to. Last year, we started somewhere around Sunk Rock and made our way in the channel under the bridge heading towards like Tripp's Boatyard. And we had a feeling that they wouldn't get flushed out of the river, because some people say, oh, well, why don't you put them up in like Hulda Cove or something like that? There just isn't the flow there, and we don't want to trap them in a location that would ultimately see their demise. We want to put them in a deep channel, plenty of clean moving water, plenty of oxygen, and so that is what we would probably do again, unless we have any other thoughts coming from this.
Yeah, I was wondering that where you planted them last year, if you could go out and do like a test sample.
I mean, they are an animal. They're an animal in motion, so.
Well, I've looked into that. A lot of people say they swim.
Yeah.
They do swim, but they stay within a little area.
Yeah. So
can swim like 10 feet at a time, but they never really move out of it. They don't like swim up the river or swim out of the channel.
Yeah. It would be interesting to do a survey tow somewhere. I mean, scallop season is open. From what I understand, the highliner of this year caught 9. So not a good
nine.
But, yes.
But I was wondering, if, you know, just try in those areas that you planted. Just
that we planted. I mean, it would be in the channel from Shiprock towards the back eddy and into Tripp's Boatyard. I mean, Tripp's Boatyard dock sometimes will house them too. I haven't had any divers. What I really want to do is, I mean, the water's clear but cold. If we could get a diver to go look around too.
I know that Spindle Rock shore over there, even though it's very close to the mouth and it's near dredging.
Yeah.
It's going to be happening. But that always was nice bottom. I did some diving in there for a couple of people looking for moorings that they had lost.
Yeah.
And I was really surprised that the eelgrass
was nice and clean looking. And
it was clean.
Yeah.
And the bottom is not soupy.
Yeah. We don't want to dump them in like a noxic mud.
But it's kind of, you know, makes me nervous.
I would probably, with that whole dredging operation, I'd try to stay clear of
it. Yeah. And it makes you nervous that you're putting them so close to the mouth. But I will say this, I've taken a few walks around Gooseberry with the dog and over by Carrion's. When it's a good, hard northeast or east blow, you'll see some bay scallops that wash up on the shore.
Oh, absolutely. So, I've observed shells over there too.
Yeah, so I mean.
No, even live ones.
He's having success.
No, I've seen those before for years. Yeah. I don't know where they come from.
But I know Carrion's growing them out there, and it's definitely not hurting.
Yeah.
Well,
they're
surviving. Yeah. You look at a place like Nantucket that has the salinity, because ultimately what's killing them, as far as I'm concerned, is the freshwater influence. And when you have a place like Nantucket that's out in, you know, salinity central, they're able to have a good fishery of that. But, I mean, there are more than one way to skin a cat, and what we want to do and where we want to plant them. To go and put 100,000 out in the ocean, I mean,
no.
I don't know.
So do you think Chris said it would be worth us figuring out to have somebody take a look-see and see how they did last year before we plant this year? Because if we're just going to throw them in the river and they're going to vanish.
Sure.
We take out one of the small skiffs and borrow somebody's drag just to try it.
Sure.
Yeah. See what we can come up with. I mean, they're going to be a year old, so they'll be.
But that's something that's going to happen in the next few weeks, probably.
A liner in that. Yeah. Some kind of a liner in there, a dredge.
You could.
I mean, you wouldn't really, all that quarter-sized stuff would wash through.
I mean, we planted last year, so they would be the 2 years right now.
It'd be the 2 years now. I'm talking about the ones he planted last year.
Yeah, but that would be the...
So when you plant them, they're the size of what, a penny?
No.
Dime?
No, bigger, yearling. I mean, they were...
So they were at a year growth like this. Last year when you planted them.
Like a quarter?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so quarter bigger, half dollar. They were, yeah, they weren't teeny. They weren't like teeny tiny. That's
maybe those were the seven that they picked up.
What, maybe it was a seven? Yeah, right.
That's pretty good size, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, they were beautiful. It was a beautiful product. Yeah. No, it looked really nice. So that's something that we're going to go ahead. I can shift on now. I talked to Nicole in accounting, and I said, where exactly is the Shellfish Propagation Gift Fund at right now for a total? She said $260,000 right now. The costs that we would see that would decrease that number, I believe if we're going to continue moving forward and get 5,000 bushels from the Ocean Rancher, that's another $39,000. We have to pay a $1 per bushel fee, I believe, to the state. I believe it's a state. So it's another 5,000. It's not the town.
So it would be the state.
It would be, I believe it's, the Commonwealth, because I've done that before. So we would be looking at $39,000 plus another $5,000 plus the $10,000 for the $100,000. So that's what we would be looking at. So in the end, we're looking at having the Shellfish Propagation Gift Fund is still going to be over $200,000. So that's a good thing. That's money in the bank because, you know, we don't know how the Manton Foundation is going to pan out. I mean, we are still, I believe, 2 years into the 5,000, into 2 years into the 5-year program. So we still have money coming. But at the same point in time, every year I write a report to the Manton Foundation with invoices and a narrative that explains, you know, what we bought, where we put it. And knock on wood, things have been good and they've been able to re-up. But even, you know, there something could happen and they could say, oh, it's all done, sorry, we're just, you know. So this is just something to be in the back of our mind also.
So is this a 5-year plan, Chris?
Yes, it's
2024 is the second year of the current 5-year plan?
I believe so, but let me double check on that. But they've been great every springtime. They've liked our reports and they've been, because usually the check is cut sometime in the spring for us to then start operating.
Can I go back just real quick? You mentioned 45 degrees is a cutoff.
Yes.
For planting. Where do you measure that 45 degrees?
That would be the state of Massachusetts doing a reading at the surface.
But where at the surface? Because obviously, as we all know, it's different.
Well, the state has, when they take water samples, they have the little basket on a stick. They'll jam their thermometer in there and they'll just hold it under. And when it comes up, and then they'll take a look at it.
So this isn't something to be done on a daily basis. When we start to get cold and it gets close.
Yes.
You're not going to come here at 6 in the morning on a Tuesday.
No.
With there.
No. We try to get the schedule that we've been going is that we go high tide sometime around 9 a.m.
Rising tide or fall tide?
It depends. It depends. They can also, I think to start... Not sure if they do the temperature in the Taunton River, but I think that we would want it to be done in the Westport River. Yeah. That's another thing that we want to take a look at also.
So we'll do it where we're planting.
Even in the Taunton River, they're going to be dredging, and there's going to be seed they're going to be disrupting seed also there, so they don't want to be dredging when the water temperature, not only for the dredge boat and the town of Westport, would then be below that 45 degree threshold.
So it's safe to assume that the first water sample that measures 45 degrees in addition to everything else is the cutoff?
Would be, yeah. Yeah. Just another update. Right now we use 3 skiffs sometimes within the Shellfish Department. We have our 24-foot Carolina skiff, we have our 17-foot Carolina skiff, and then we have the Franklin and Payne or Payne and Wade or whatever the aluminum boat is. Just in doing maintenance on that outboard, the Honda on the green skiff is the oldest, and it is from 2014. I said, oh, is 10 years old. I know Gary Sherman would replace outboards every 5 years. So I would probably look when, for the two boats that we might think about repowering for this department, would be that Honda that's 10 years old. It's time. And if we're going to do that, we might take a look when the 24-foot Carolina skiff goes out to say, how many hours are on this? And what, you know, what's the overall condition of that? Because those are two workhorse boats that we want to have functioning, you know, tip-top.
Where is the aluminum skiff?
At my house. Oh. Yeah. Instead of going and paying a lot of money to have somebody change the oil and do these kinds of things, I changed the oil myself. You know, we just try to beat down costs. I know that we've taken a look at the Shellfish budget, and I believe there's $1,000 total for equipment repair and maintenance. So that can get eaten up pretty quick when you're dealing with a fuel pump or something like that. Oh, it's a $700 bill. Well, you know, that there goes 70% of your equipment repair and maintenance. So I think in just good housekeeping, that 10-year-old outboard, yeah, it's time for a new one. The 24-foot Carolina skiff, yeah, we need to take a look at that and make sure. Yeah, we did put a fuel pump in it. Yeah, these are just kind of wear and tear things, but ultimately, we don't want to be going halfway through the season and then having to ferry the 24-foot Carolina skiff with something else. You know, we want to make sure that we have all of our equipment. So I think that I would probably take a look at that and then put in an article from the Municipal Waterways Fund that would then purchase those outboards for those boats. Because to ask the general fund for it or something like that, usually when we put in for something like that, we're on the bottom of the list.
What size is the Honda?
40.
40?
Yeah. So that would conclude my update.
Okay. Well, this is going to the next thing is the going to go back to you. Steps needed is to reopen White's Flats.
Yeah.
That's a good real recreational area. And, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
Nice clean water, sandy bottom.
So what happened on White's Flat in that area? Because the areas in which we take water samples, there's one in Halda Cove, there's one at Point Bile, and then one moving up. The Halda Cove and Point Bile had failed so many times that they had to then create a closure. We did do, if everybody remembers, we had an outfit come in to look at fecal bacteria from streams within that area, and it was inconclusive as to what kind of, you know, if it was bird or whatever, but we're looking at, right now we're looking at birds. Sometimes, you know, the birds migrate, and sometimes if it's a warm winter, maybe they don't migrate as much, but that is an area in which there's a lot of ducks, a lot of swans, a lot of cormorants, there's all kinds of stuff that's there. And for some reason, that area doesn't drain and flush as well as you think it would, especially with the Federal Channel, the mouth of the river, and all of this kind of stuff. So I emailed Terry, and we have had, we're looking at 15 samples that were collected. We have a lot of really clean samples, but I'm not going to read the whole email. I'll pass it to you guys to take a look. But it basically says we need to continue to get samples from this area in the wintertime, which is proven good. We also need a July and August sampling in there that is good. But we would want to make sure that when we do sample, it's not on a moon or a king tide. A lot of bird stuff comes off of the marshes at that point in time, which could definitely affect it. You know, when we go water testing, we're not going to water test in the slimy, you know, areas of what we're looking at. You know, we want to test the good water, and especially if birds are present, which they are every single time, we don't want to get right next to the birds, you know, but we want to be in that area. But I can pass this along to you to just read that email. So I believe that it was saying that the earliest would be sometime next summer, after the July and August, and we are able to get those good tests specifically in those 2 months.
Does that include Hicks Cove?
It is in the portion of the closure area, so yes.
Okay.
We're talking about BB 3.31, which is the whole, that whole area.
That whole area. Yep, yeah, and if so, if you guys want to just take a look at that email, it.
I'll make copies and.
Yeah.
Unless you want to look at it now.
Okay.
Okay, what? I'll make emails and send a copy to everyone, but if you want to look at it closely.
But that's just, that's what we're looking at, with that area.
That's progress.
Yeah, well, the whole thing is because we know when we were getting bad samples in a certain time, you know, we want to make sure that the times in which we go and sample, you know, that we're not shooting ourselves in the foot. Because there has been times where we've gone out and we've just had an opening over a very large rainfall time. And we looked at each other and said, maybe we should, you know.
You say we, the state?
The state.
Yes, good.
Yeah, because we don't want to shoot ourselves in the foot. We've been trying to get those good.
They're on our side. Good.
Yeah.
Okay, the next thing is, move along here, is set date for opening up the West Branch on the River Roadside in the Half Moon Flat area for December.
Let's see, number four. The West Branch, we went out and I did testing yet again with the state a couple of weeks ago, and we are set to open November 1. So that area north of Tom's Point up to Judy's Island and 294 River Road is set to open with clean samples for November 1. So it would be up to this board's decision, it would be up for this advisory committee's decision to maybe take a look to say, well, if the seasonal conditional area is going to open up in the West Branch on November 1, what do we think about Judy's Island? What do we think about 294? Or do we just want to hold and keep going?
Did you want to have anything for Christmas?
Well, we can talk.
So let's hear it.
For the soonest that we can open up Half Moon Flat would be December 10th, and it's a Tuesday.
Well, let's keep on this. Is there something holding us from opening both west and east sides?
No. Oh. No, we can, no.
Do they need to test meats?
No. The
water's good, the meats are good.
The meats are good, the water's good November 1. It's up to us to make that decision whether we would want to open that up on November 1 preliminarily to the Half Moon Flat opening, or if we wanted to hold that for later. Keep in mind.
In the winter, yeah.
But keep in mind also that the door is going to shut on that also, yeah, because that is a seasonal conditional area.
Yeah.
I would the like door shutting meeting that it's gonna, on the
that
other end.
That it's going to close on the other end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's in a rain conditional area, so it can rain next week and it'll be closed.
And then it'll
next
be closed.
Year. Like,
oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. So that's something also to keep into account.
So, you know, in my opinion, I still think we should open up Half Moon Flat in December and, you know, Judy's Island and the west side of at the same time. Since one's gonna close,
yep,
at the end of what is it, the end of April?
Yes.
And it's in a rain closed area, like just so you can keep people in business. What do you guys think?
Well, I believe the market's pretty soft right now.
Yeah, I heard that so the guy in Wayham's not taking
probably not a good idea to open up the West Branch, the Judy's Island. Right now.
Well, we could. I mean, if we wanted to hold till December, if we wanted to hold till December 10th, let Half Moon Flat get blasted, and then after that, what are we opening next? And it could be that Judy's Island and 294 River Road, because the next opening that we're looking at
December 10th.
Yeah.
Is Half Moon.
Yes, we still need to get meat samples. I'm gonna for Half Moon Flat. We're gonna go out early-ish November to get meat samples and also samples at Hicks Bridge area. If for some reason the Hicks Bridge area fails, we'll then have the time to open it up before December 10th. We could do a second run the second or third week in November to see if we could open up that oyster area too, because that's something. There's a lot of factors and a lot of things that are playing into this right now. And, I mean, I think we're in agreement that we don't want to open in a soft market. We want to get the best bang for our buck, and we don't want things hanging out in space in the terms of people have three bushels and nowhere to sell them.
The market's only going to be soft for another couple of weeks.
Yeah, that's true.
John, what do you mean when you get into the second week of November?
Would it be smart then to keep the West Branch and Judy's Island of BB3.2 and BB3.19 and open them at the same time as Half Moon? And then that way, if you get a ring closure up there, we still have Half Moon. And then it may also take some of the pressure off of Half Moon. You know, that's like a...
Well, everybody's going to go to
Half Moon. Yeah, everybody's going to go to Half Moon.
It's winter time and...
Well, that can freeze over too. It gives them an option, you know.
Yeah.
But I think
that was my thought, but...
We do want Judy's Island and 294 River Road, seeing that it's already cycled once and we weren't able to clean it up. We don't want it to cycle another year, and then we wouldn't be able to plant it. That would be also creative an issue.
I guess that's an idea, open them both up in December.
Yeah. Seeing that it is such a short window up there. Yeah. Because Half Moon Flat is going to get blasted, and then we at least have something else that would be open until the next opening, and then we're going to talk about that, I think, in the Great Island.
But nonetheless, the West Branch shuts down on April 1. April
30th. 30th, yeah.
Okay.
So.
Is there much left that David wrote?
I didn't go this week, but last week. I don't know who's been up there.
From what I've heard, the channel at David Road.
Oh, the channel's like beat.
This is all
flat ground, out of the boat stuff.
This is out of the boat.
Somebody told me they expected to be up here 7 hours to get through both of us.
I talked to somebody that went up there. They said it took them nine.
It took what?
9 hours to get three.
It's a better man than I.
That
maybe not.
Fisherman lot.
Not a spot. Maybe not. It took them 9 hours.
All right.
I agree.
So should we bring...
Do we have to motion this, or just not really?
I think
no. No, it's just something.
Okay, so do you agree on that? Opening up...
Point for discussion.
Both, yeah, I mean,
Half Moon Flat and the West Branch and...
Would you Judy's
want Island all at the same time?
I mean, if November 1 is an opening time, I mean, would we want to beat the clock and have that open in the West Branch? Let me just take a look, because it would be on a Tuesday, Thursday, or Saturday.
Well, I thought we just said we didn't want to open it up under a soft market.
Okay, yeah.
But say before, it could be earlier than the 10th, like before Thanksgiving, or right before... Week before when things...
So it would be like the November, we could open it November 19th, which would be the third week in November for 294 in Judy's Island.
Okay.
And being two tents, it's a crap shot.
It's a crap shoot, yeah.
It's
we're in a drought right now, but...
So
that's going to change.
That's bound to change. That's why I was in favor of Shiprock, Sunk Rock, because at some point moving ahead, we're going to get into a rainy season again, and we need to provide for that scenario.
Okay.
So November 19th, which would be a Tuesday?
Yep.
For West Branch.
For the West Branch, for 294 River Road and Judy's
Island. Both sides, yeah.
Both sides.
And then the 17th of December for Half Moon.
No, it would be the 10th, which would be a Tuesday.
A Tuesday, yeah.
And that would be the soonest, that the absolute soonest that we could open up.
So that's going to be November 19th.
November 19th or
November 19th for the West Branch.
Yes, Tuesday, November 19th.
294 River and Judy's Island.
Yep.
And the 10th for Half Moon.
I don't know if we can really set a date on that if we don't have meat samples.
Well, we're going to do the meat samples. I've never had a meat sample come back bad, but you know what?
It's possible.
I mean, anything is possible.
Don't we adjustment? Either way, we have to make an adjustment if it doesn't.
Okay. Does the state test the meats in the Taunt River?
Yes. Before every season. Absolutely.
Okay. And that's usually a big failure. Do you know what the results are on that?
I don't think that that's in my...
No, I'm just curious.
I haven't had it fail.
They were.
Yeah, oh, I mean, yeah, it's...
It must be bad.
I think they're more searching for viruses and things that could spread pathogens, because we know that they are, we know that they're fecally bacteria can...
Yeah, we know there's fecal coliform in there, but is there, you know, high concentrations of other things?
Yes.
They must look at heavy metals.
Heavy metals, yep.
PCBs.
I didn't want to say that.
Well, it's basically anything that the FDA would say this is a non-saleable food product.
So basically everything. Moving on.
Okay. So I was thinking about changing the Great Island relay, moving that out to...
What about five?
Oh, yeah.
Forgot number five.
Oh, okay. Possible dates for Cadman's Neck oyster fishing. Cadman's Neck North, past Hicks Bridge.
Yep. Like I said earlier, I've talked with the state for water testing. We plan on going out in early November to do a run up there. We'd like to see it open December 1, but ultimately the factor that is going to be the open or close is going to be, did the water test come back good? So that's why we wanted to go in earlier November, because the last run that we did, we had really good, it's been really good water. So if for some reason in early November it fails, we would then have a second opportunity in later in November. And then if it fails again in later in November, then it's going to bump that date to December 15th or later, which has happened in the past.
If you get a good water test December 1st.
December 1. Would be the opening.
Opening up.
Yeah, because we're not just, we can't just open it on, it's December 1st, let's open it. We need the data of good, clean water samples to then open it. So I have plans with the state early November to do the meat samples from Half Moon Flat, and then we're going to get that, and then we're going to go up Hicks Bridge area, north of Cadman's Neck and Cadman's Cove, to then do some water testing, so we have it mapped out.
Hopefully sooner than later, it's been dry.
This is also true. Yeah.
So the question I got regarding the oysters, the three cutting back down to two baskets, does that start next year, January, or does that start this year?
January 1.
That would start January 1.
Okay.
So when the old licenses
when the expire. Old, when the old right. licenses renew. Right.
So we can do three until January 1.
Right.
Okay. Got it.
But as far as getting out of the boat up there, would that be January 1 also?
I think so. That all goes into it.
That doesn't...
Because the licenses that were sold are still in...
Okay.
Yeah, the licenses that were sold this year are still in full effect.
Okay.
Until we make that change.
So everything will change on January 1.
It has to be in print, too. People got to read it.
Yeah.
So until we can get that printed, you have to abide by what's currently...
I guess if you don't have time to make new booklets, you can just have an insert, like Gary used to do.
What we have right now is we have this booklet. On the website, I believe it's under the Harbor Master Department, and I'm working on that, but this whole thing, it's on the internet now. And so we're just going to, because the price...
It's easier to change.
Yeah, the price of printing booklets, I think, is... I don't know, $1,200, $1,500.
Most other towns have everything on.
Is just, on yeah. And where I've talked to the town clerk this morning, and we are making all Shellfish licenses available except for commercial licenses will be able to be bought online. Commercial licenses, you're going to have to come in, show your ID, and talk to a person to get your commercial license. But that's where that's heading at this point in time. Because the town clerk doesn't have enough to do right now.
I went over there today to ask some questions. And I said, I'll come back another day.
Yeah, it's...
All right, so we're on to number six. So at one of the meetings, we thought about opening that up in February. And to me, February is another slow time, right?
Sure.
Right, especially with two areas already open.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we're thinking up May, you know, it starts, people start cooking out, Memorial Day and all that.
That's definitely better.
So I was thinking about 5, 10.
Yeah, no, I think it, the thing that I, well, I think maybe the commercial fishing public would want everything to open all at once. Let's, you know, but we have to be the gatekeepers that say, we need to keep the money in the bank and we just can't go on a spending spree. So I think that that's a wise decision.
I think it makes a lot more sense to spread it all out.
Oh, yes, no, absolutely.
Day of the week.
Oh, I don't know. I usually go for a Saturday because Gary Sherman used to do Saturdays.
Well, up there, it's different for a Saturday, too.
That's the 10th of May?
Yeah, my calendar don't go that far.
What'd you say, Chris? I'm sorry?
May 10th.
Yeah.
Chris?
Do we need to vote on that?
I didn't hear, what'd you say?
Because we voted on February 11th before.
May 10th is a Saturday.
I don't believe that this, I mean, would have to go before the select board.
No.
But it would be, you know, the advisory committee's decision to set the date. I'm not sure if that needs a motion or not, seeing that it doesn't have to go before the select board.
I'm just asking because we voted on it at the last meeting, I think.
Yeah, that's what I asked before when we were talking about all this other stuff.
Had to go to May.
Chris, where did you say the?
I think so.
The booklet is?
The booklet's on the Harbor Master page.
On your page, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm trying to get it moved over to the Shellfish page.
I just went to the town page, actually, and the town page has not been updated. Still says 5 bushels of cohogs.
They're going to create a new website for the town. And so there's a lot of things that are out in space right now. But this booklet is on there, but we're just trying to clean up everything because we're having the new website. I'm not sure that when that's going to be launched. But we've been working on updating all of the pages because I know the pages are still horrendous. So, yeah. Let me look into that and make sure that we can clean that up because we don't want bad information out there.
Right, so we are saying Great Island will be May.
Like, everybody's all in agreement with that? And that's a rain-closed area, so like the last time it was open, it lasted forever because of, right, John?
That's right. Went for a long time.
Yeah. And it's mostly bull rake, and not everybody likes the bull rake.
I would have to say the problem that I can see within that area and opening it, there's one problem, and it is boat traffic because some of that stuff is planted within the channel, and if you wait till May, then, you know, we'll see. Because we have had issues of people falling over from boat wake and all this kind of stuff. There's nothing in the Harbor Master rules and regulations per se giving way to a commercial fisherman that's actively fishing. There might be some state regulations that are out there, but that would just be for operating your boat within 150 feet from a moored boat, an anchored boat, something like that.
Okay, move on to the next discussion.
Next.
Discussing setting up funding for the, I don't know, my typing wasn't that good, for the town dock up downweller.
So what we can take a look at, we know that the downweller is going to be an important part of us in the future of the Shellfish Department. Specifically with the Manton Foundation funding, the dredge boat operation. I wish everything could last forever, but sometimes it doesn't. And so with the help of Bill Chase and getting that back up and painted and solid, right now we're just looking at a couple of pumps that we would put together, hopefully for this coming season. Just looking at the budget right now, the equipment repair and maintenance for the Shellfish Department. We do have some expenses here. We could also look into if Shellstock would want to not only include the Shellfish Propagation Fund, but we do have a Shellfish Equipment Fund that is active that I think if we were able to kind of get a small stream into that equipment fund, because I'll tell you right now, the equipment fund doesn't have much in it. So that would be one mechanism that we would be able to get some donations into that Shellfish Equipment Fund that is in place, just like the Shellfish Propagation Gift Fund.
Bill, are you heading up the downwaller?
Well, I worked on it last year at Chris's behest.
I remember John asking me about a couple of pumps.
Oh, John was all psyched about it.
I found a couple of pumps that may be good. Should I just give them to you to check out?
Yeah, I think the general consensus is what we need is a submersible pump. Something that we can just pull up and clean out and just drop near the bottom again.
It's got to be submersible?
That, all the discussions that I've had with those who do these things, and there have been a few, all go to the submersible side. And if you look at how it was set up originally, there was a big old electric motor, which I'm sure drew some electricity to keep it going. And Chris said it overheated, and it wasn't actually the right application for that. The PVC piping is basically in place. Wouldn't take too much to get that piece back together. But just tying in a reliable submersible pump, I think, would solve the problem. We don't need a lot of water flow in those downwells. So, and the prices that I looked at, anywhere between $500 and $1,500, depending on where you want it to go with this.
Yeah.
So I don't see a lot of capital outlay to get this up and running again. I mean, it's fairly close right now. Just we got to kind of pick up where we left off to get it going. I think my question to all of you is, besides, you know, laying out a grand or two to get it going, what's the ultimate goal of this? What are we going to do? Whether it's going to be oysters, is it going to be scallops, is it going to be quahog seed, and to what end?
I think a lot of it is what's available to us at the time when we would want to start operation. Just to back up a minute, I know that Gary Sherman had used just the ACE, what do they call it, like a basement pump.
Yeah.
What
I read some
pump. Oh, a sump pump. Thank you. Yeah, that they were used, like the 110 sump pump. The pump that was in place was like a 220 pump, I think, and it was designed to push water horizontally, not draw water from, you know, 8, 10 feet vertically. Then and that's where the lift was the thing that was causing that pump to overheat and just draw a lot.
Gary Sherman had a lot of help with that. He had some BCC agriculture people helping, Fishermen's Association helping, and then Jack Scammell's little derpy aquaculture class. So he had a lot of people helping out, so that's one thing you're going to have to do is get a lot of volunteers. And plus he had a woman, what was her name?
Deb.
Debbie.
Yeah.
There was this Debbie, he had the grant money for her to
That's also something that I'd like to look into for grant money for municipal aquaculture. Or maybe just aquaculture in general. I'm sure there's grant money for aquaculture.
Oh, yes, there is.
Because, yeah. So that's another mechanism that we would have to go into. Because I think if we were to split proceeds from Shellstock or something to that effect for where Shellstock is going right now, I'm not sure if we're ready to do that. I mean, that would be up for the advisory committee to take a look at.
Just a thought on that note, Chris. We had a brief conversation with Roger Williams. Should we? Academia always does a better job at grant money, grant writing than municipalities. So maybe we should start there. I mean, if we get a pump, I'll get to be a pump if we have to. But maybe we should talk to Roger Williams again, that gentleman, the two guys who came down.
Tim Scott was the second one. He was the big guy.
He's retired.
Yeah, he did say he was about to.
Perfect time for the volunteer.
Yeah, he mentioned that meeting. So
maybe we could start that conversation again. It's been, you know, since the spring, since we had that conversation.
Well, I mean, just recapping those conversations, we met with Dr. Andrew Rise. That was the first meeting that we had.
Yeah.
He's moved on now from aquaculture to some other department. But I recall the conversation down at the point, he was pretty excited about the Westport River being a wonderful place for this kind of activity,
mm-hmm.
just because of the water quality, so on and so forth. And then we met with Tim on it was in June, I want to say the 6th or 7th of June,
right.
In the summer, and he was the guy who wrote a lot of the grants that Dr. Rise was using to fund his projects. From the conversation with Tim Scott, I got tied into Dale Levitt, who is, by everyone's opinion, one of the experts in the world in aquaculture, but he's working for a private firm now. He's left Roger Williams some time ago. This is a man that John talked about kind of often. So the point I'm trying to make is that we have a lot of expertise at our fingertips.
A lot of resources available.
And we've brought them in to discuss it, but we haven't come up with any kind of a concrete plan as to where we want to go with it, if anywhere at all. So I guess my question again is, assuming we come up with the money to get it up and running and purchase the seed, what do we do with it? I mean, what's the next step beyond all of that?
One of the guys we talked to, I don't know which one it was, but we mentioned that we could get some oysters from Westport. And give them to Roger Williams, and they could spat them and then give them back to us, and we could put them in our upwelling, which might, since they came from Westport, they might have a better chance and actually do the same thing with quahogs. Get Westport quahogs, give them to Roger Williams, let them spat them, and then, you know, give us the little seed to put inside the downwell or whatever they call
it. So I guess my question is, would it be better use of our time and effort to try to circle the wagons again with those guys, or their designees from and after their retirements or whatever, have a conversation with them, figure out, let's hear what they have to say about moving forward, and rather than us spin our wheels and kind of get lost in the shuffle and go nowhere or go a little bit at a time, take their expertise, see what they have to say, and we can do that in short order, and then, you know, bring it forward and move forward from there. Let them kind of give us a roadmap on what's successful. I mean, Gary Sherman knew, but...
Having worked under Gary Sherman, in my experience with this whole thing, it's a very small window of growing time. Right. So the bigger the seed or the animal that you have in there, the better. And I will tell you, having worked under Gary Sherman and growing things with him, the window in which you're growing, which would be springtime to then a time right about now where the water cools off a little bit, predation goes down, and that's when you want to plant, because you don't want to plant this stuff. Let's just look at your thumbnail growing and the white of your thumbnail. So let's just say April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November. That might be a long time for that. And then we're gonna look at, well, how much electricity are we gonna use to have these pumps running continually? And then after the, let's just say for more or less 6 months, 4 to 6 months that we would be raising them, how big are they really going to grow? And a lot of it has to do with, you know, maybe your fingernails growing. How quickly does a tree grow and the rings on a tree? And I'll tell you, it's not much. You think that you're going to, you know, put in these little things and then out are going to pop these 2-inch oysters, maybe. I know quahogs are very slow to grow too, where you could see the growth ring on it. And how big was the growth ring? Oh, you know, like that, about that much. So that's something that we have to take into. It's not a fast process.
It seems to me, though, this might be a great vehicle for enhancing the oyster stock that we currently have.
And the scallops. There's no reason why we can't do it.
I was getting to that too, but I mean, we've taken a lot of effort with the culching and everything else to enhance the oyster beds such as they are. It seems to me purchasing seed and growing them to a bigger size and then dumping them on top of those oyster beds would only enhance what we currently have.
I think we do a lot with quahogs. I think that we could definitely look at oysters specifically in the area of Higgs Bridge for a re-nourishment, a replenishment, because at this point in time, the only thing that's doing that is Mother Nature. So I think
we know the oysters are successful and driven.
Yeah.
Salinity and everything is very good.
Yeah. So we want to grow things that
proven success.
That is proven success. To grow quahog seed to, you know, in 6 months we grew it that much. Okay. cool. You know, but when we look at, I think we have the quahog base covered. I think that we could do the lion's share of oysters, and if we wanted to mess around with some base scallops, but I mean,
not
we'll,
to mention we have carrion.
But we have carrion. We have.
I mean, if we have a problem, who better to ask?
Yeah. So I think that I think that it would be good to focus on oysters in that downweller would probably be a good start to be planted in the Hicksbridge area. Also, I know we talked about it before to have a, and this might be getting ahead of myself a little bit, but down the road to be able to spawn bay scallops artificially outside of the natural window in which they do spawn. Does that make sense? Where?
Yeah.
Where the water's going to hit? Yeah, to force a spawn. To force a spawn of bay scallops.
By making the
conditions correct.
Conditions correct for when they do it, because it's basically in nature, it's all based on temp.
Yes. So if that's something, I don't know if we're going to get to that this coming year, but I think that if just looking at big colors and big shapes, to get a couple of sump pumps, if that's what we got to do, and some oyster seed. So we can plan ahead right now also with oyster seed, because just if everything gets up and running, we say, oh, we want to buy oyster seed. And they're like, well, where are you going to get it from? A lot of these people, there's waiting lists and things like that. But
the guy from Roger Williams said we could put in, we'd have to talk to Carrie and put in an order when he puts in his order.
Yep.
Remember that?
Piggybacking
off of him.
But when we...
And that was early January, where most of these guys put their orders in for delivery in May.
But luckily we do have carrion to get seed. And when we're going
to
look
not to interrupt, Chris. His one thing that I did learn, you know, there are wild oysters and there are farm-raised. There are diploids, which are farm-raised, and there are triploids. Mm-hmm. I've got that backwards. And diploids are wild, the triploids are modified.
Sure.
Why would you put a modified oyster in a wild oyster bed?
But you can buy the diploids. So if we put an order in, we'd make sure we got the
diploids. Yeah, no, I'm saying, because we're talking about carrion, he's dealing with...
Yeah, but this guy said that carrion could order some of those too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that might be... We also need to take a look at the trays in the downweller setup and to see what we could hold without overcrowding, because we don't want to overcrowd, to see exactly... How much product are we looking at once we fill those trays?
How much can we hold?
How much? Yeah, because that's also a factor.
Do you know that answer?
Well,
10 cubic feet a piece, so I don't know how many levels.
Yeah, but
put it.
Is it their single level? Single level trays.
Do we know what the answer is? Do we know
how
many we can hold?
I'm going to say overall in town baskets of seed, we'll just go simple terms here, maybe a couple town baskets of seed. Something like that.
So which brings me back to my point is that should we, this committee or as many as can attend, have a meeting with the guys or the designees from the last meeting we had last spring and get their input and then go off and running from that. Let's see what they have to say. I mean, information.
I do recall Tim Scott saying you can get this up and running for $10,000. And I think more of that was discussion of the cost of the seed. As you know, again, a couple of thousand to get the building up and running and $10,000 for seed.
I was thinking more of the process. You know, how do we get there? How do we get to the point where we're going to say we need $10,000?
I don't really think it's that hard.
I'm sorry?
I don't think it's that hard.
No. I
don't think it needs like a lot of... I don't think it needs a lot of study.
Well, I'm not saying that, but I'm thinking the next step is if we bring academia in, it makes it easier for grants going forward, as opposed to...
I think that once we get the upweller running and we have an order for seed, we get some seed, that's when we need to make our move to put the seed in and watch it go.
Is there any reason we couldn't target this January to put in an order for
seed? I'm wondering. Why not? Because
why not?
If we we have until May or so, right?
Yeah.
Before it gets delivered.
Mm-hmm.
Why not?
I mean...
We're gonna get the money.
We know that the oysters will survive almost unimpeded.
Right.
So even if we're not doing everything 100% correct, I think that we'll still have some success. And the learning curve will be sharp in the beginning, but we all know as fishermen ourselves that the easiest way to master it is to keep doing it.
Mm-hmm.
I think the easiest thing is get this, I mean, for $500, we could get two sump pumps, we could get whatever PVC fittings, whatever hoses, whatever kind of connections. We get the trays in there, and then we see what a tray can hold. Times how many trays, and that's gonna be our answer right there.
Yeah, but where do we get the money to do this right now?
Well, if it's $500 that we're gonna then...
Can you take it out? You can't take it out of the gift fund, can you?
For the seed, absolutely.
For the pumps and stuff?
Well, if the pumps, a sump pump, a third horse sump pump from Ace is like $120.
Yeah,
so, and those are, and those
I
usually,
think it's a little more than that, but
it's probably gone up by now.
They are readily available.
What is it, a Wayne pump or whatever you beat on them at all? Is it? I know I have one of those in my house, and that thing's 3 years old, and it's just keeps going.
I don't know how well they run continually.
That's the also thing.
Running, but I can find that out. There's got to be. I wouldn't go with a sump pump. I'd go with a submersible.
Yeah. I know Gary Sherman used the sump pumps, and they would last one season, and that was it. And then you throw it out. But for an investment of $150 per pump, what the heck?
So can you take that money out of the gift fund?
No, for the equipment would come out of the Shellfish Department budget.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, that's okay. We're looking at it. I mean, okay, so instead of spending $500 on shirts, we spend $500 on pumps, and you're just going to wear your old shirt.
Okay.
I mean, you know, that's where we're at. I mean, you guys have seen the budget.
You've got to make cuts in some places to get other stuff.
And well, we've been cut a few times.
You don't get a paint job.
Well, let me just give a little what if. What if it cost us $2,000 to get the facility up and running? And what if it cost $10,000 to buy a mess of oyster seed?
I think $10,000 for the oyster seed is high for what it is.
But that,
for what we can hold.
He just threw that number out.
Yeah, for what we could hold. I mean, ultimately, yeah. I think $10,000 is a top of the line number.
At least the oyster seed we can pull out of the Shellfish Propagation Fund.
Yes.
Oh yeah, any seed.
$200,000 in there, so that's not going to hurt us.
Yeah.
Like Ron says, it's just finagling how to get the pumps paid for. I think all the seed we can.
Yeah.
That's what it's for.
The sump pumps are nice, but they're only going to get us through one season. But ultimately, what is the shelf life of another submersible? Actually designed for the right thing.
We also have irons in the fire with shell stock, and we're changing that entity into something else that would, in the future, moving forward, would be able to say, okay, here's, you know, $2,500 to go ahead and put those pumps. So I think it's really just getting over the initial hump to get going, and I think that all the wheels are in motion moving forward to help fund.
Well, if $12,000 is that magic number,
yeah,
why can't we get this going this year?
Well, I mean, right now the season's passed, so we would be looking at this coming spring. And there's no reason.
No, I'm talking
yeah,
about...
No, there's no reason for 2025.
Putting the order in with Carrion just kind of piggybacking on him.
Yeah, I mean, and we would probably go to Carrion's expertise, too, to have the trays, because it's single-level trays, to say,
exactly,
how much could you fit in these?
He'll know.
Oh, he'd know. He'd take a look at it and say, yeah, this is what you need. So... All right, so we have forward motion in that. That's good.
Yeah, I think we have a plan. Sounds good.
So just for the minutes, recap it for me. This conversation.
Watch the video.
Are you out of your mind?
So we're gonna move forward with trying to get. We're gonna price the pumps out. Find the pumps.
Chris is gonna buy the pumps.
How much that's gonna cost? And we're gonna try and order the seed for January. For this January, so that it can be delivered to us or available to us in May.
Before May.
And hopefully between now and May, we can have the downweller
up and running,
ready to go, so it's ready to accept that seed.
We make two, Ron made the a really good point before. It's not like you're going to be able to turn the pump on and walk away.
Right.
Somebody's going to have to keep an eye on this on a pretty regular basis, you know, and I...
We'll all have to pitch in.
And I remember, I talked to Rich Hill about this. This was right after John passed. I said, would you stop down and have a chat? I have a question for you. And I said to him, what does it take to do all of this as far as the aquaculture side of things? And he said, it takes two things, labor and money. You're going to be chasing labor all the time. You're going to be chasing money all the time.
Yeah.
Right? And I'm sure that with his expertise, that's spot on. So I guess this is more of a heads up, like if we're going down this road, somebody better be ready to come clean out the sump pump on a regular basis and keep an eye on things.
Just as a side note, right now, we have, for the overall budget, around $12,000 for part-time help. Whether that's an hour or 2 hours, three times a week, or whatever that translates into.
What budget is that in?
That's the Shellfish budget.
Okay.
For part-time as needed help.
And has that got a designation of what that can be used for? Or is it just any part-time help?
The Shellfish department.
Okay, good.
So when you need help driving the truck, does that come out of that?
If it's the
Shellfish. If it's part-time as needed, absolutely.
If it's Shellfish related, right?
Yep.
I remember talking to Gary Shipp about this very issue, and he said, you know, we really need that building. And I have to say, I spent a lot of hours in there last winter just doing buoys and all. So, yeah, it's nice to have that. I don't think getting the upwell is up and running gets in the way of that.
No.
You can do both.
No. And specifically, that building is utilized kind of off-season for preparatory type stuff. But once summer hits, I mean, if we wanted to expand the downweller to inside or something like that, I know that having a field trip for kids, kind of what Demarest Lloyd has. I don't know if we want to get to the touch a tank type of stuff, but you know, we could definitely replicate. You know, that and move it inside if we wanted to. You know, there's room to grow or whatever, but that building is utilized on the off season for preparatory type of stuff.
Not tomorrow, let them people in town see what we're doing. You know?
Oh yeah, high visibility.
I mean, most of the educational stuff that Gary had put in the building is still there.
Yep.
Okay, we all set.
Number eight.
For some reason, or the state has two different age groups for commercial shellfishing is 14 years old and 15 years old to pull an aquaculture license. And our book is 16, but I'm motioning just to keep that at 16 years old, not to try to... you know, follow the states.
I second that motion.
Any discussion?
I mean, it's been in the book. We'll let it stay the same.
Why would we change it?
Exactly.
I think it came up somewhere along the line.
Pressure from fishing pressure, so why would we invite more?
Somebody made a great point. Less than 16, they can't even drive a car. So they can't get there.
You can drive an outboard, though.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah.
And that's exactly right.
Yeah.
What was that?
You can drive an outboard. I mean, when I was a kid, I used to go to
by
boat.
You got to get to the boat.
A lot of people live in Westport and walk down the hill and get in the boat.
Walk down the hill and get in the boat, exactly.
Those days are hard.
Not so much. You want to vote on that?
If it's no change, then it's no change.
Okay.
I mean, there's no
change. It was just brought up.
If it was changing, we would need something.
Paula called me a couple times about it. I don't know when it ever came up, but I got to just get back to it.
She may have been keeping her finger on the pulse. Yeah. Just making sure we weren't falling behind in any state rules.
Okay, a motion to adjourn the meeting.
Oh, the, can we just do one more thing? I'm sorry, because we...
Other business?
Just the other business, I meant to put it in the update. Just the numbers from Shellstock. I have the most current numbers, and we're still collecting, we're still collecting, you know, people are buying posters and
apparel.
Things like that, yeah. So for 2024 Shellstock, our gross total was $45,477.85. That was our gross total. Now, we have our expenses, which was a total of, the expenses was $14,284.16. $14,284.16. And so we're looking at a net profit for Shellstock 2024 at $31,193.69. And I just wanted to make sure that that hit this meeting, because I know it's part of the update that I missed, and we're going to update it now.
And saying that Shellstock was down this year, as we all know, attendance was lower and numbers were lower. I think 31,000 is darn good. Mm-hmm. That's for, and that's a down year.
Yeah. We're going to have up and down.
That buys a lot of co-ops.
Yeah. No, that's great.
A lot of clams. That buys a lot of clams.
A lot of clams to buy a lot of clams.
Yes.
That's right. Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Aye.